All right, welcome to the video. I don't like the tape unless I really can lay it on the line. And sometimes I feel, you know, so exhausted, but right now I seem to have a little bit of energy, which is a great thing. So I've got a little bit of bite to what I have to say, which is important. I was listening to this talk radio station a little bit today, and it's the same old thing. They say, you know, this is awful, this is terrible, look what's happening. And they're just pointing out, you know, wow, yeah, it is terrible, it is awful. And then they end up by saying, why is this happening? You know, why is this happening? What's... And that's what they leave you with, just this frustrated up feeling, like, wow, it's all terrible, why is it happening? They never tell you why is it really happening, and two, what to do about it. Never. And so it... You know, it's a complete waste of time. Right here, we tell you why it's happening and what to do about it. So this is worth your attention. Whereas the other, if they don't tell you why is it happening, what to do about it, why is that worth your time and your attention, it's not really worth it. Actually, this is my beef with a lot of the commentary in the world. They don't know why it's happening. I point, and here in these videos, it's pointed out, why is this happening? And I'm telling you that it is an incorporation on this planet. This planet is being incorporated by cosmic corporate culture. This is a term that I've coined. And the roots of the situation on this planet right now extend far beyond the boundaries of this planet. It extends to other star systems throughout the galaxy. And so we're up against something that is extremely arrogant and with tremendous spiritual pride, which is why we're having such difficulty with it, which is why you have to turn to divinity in order to withstand what's going on, which many people in this world realize. And what's being demonized on this planet is people turning to divinity and asking for help, because that's the only remedy for this cosmic corporate culture and corporation takeover of this planet, is divine help. It's the only remedy. This is why the whole idea of turning to divinity for help is being demonized. Cosmic corporate culture demonizes it because they're afraid of it. It threatens them because they know that has the power to withstand their pride, spirit, arrogance and pride. Okay. So the remedy, what's the remedy? Turn to divinity. That's the remedy. The term Christ, let's look at the term Christ. They hate that term. They hate the term Jesus Christ. They hate the term Christ. It frightens them to death. I submit to you that the term Christ really means pure spaciousness. Okay, Christ consciousness means the consciousness of pure spaciousness. This is what our goal is actually here, is to attain Christ consciousness. You might, other traditions call it enlightenment, self-realization, various terms. Christ consciousness, the awareness of pure spaciousness. You know, the term Christ comes from the Jewish term Messiah, which comes from the root, means to smear olive oil, to smear on, to paint on. And olive oil, all the kings and the priests and the prophets in Judaism were anointed with olive oil on their head. And olive oil is a disinfectant also. Preservative, disinfectant. But the idea of oil, okay, the idea of this oil or being anointed. What is everything actually anointed with? It really means anointed with, to be anointed with something sacred. Okay, it's in a sacred anointing. This is what Christ really means, the term. What is everything actually anointed with? Everything is this bottle. Everything is anointed with pure spaciousness, actually. And this is what we're not recognizing. This is what we're refusing to recognize. This is what the cosmic corporate culture refuses to recognize. We're refusing to recognize it because we want to be greater than God. We want to believe that reality is flawed. And then this would make us feel that then by transcending the flaws or working on the flaws, adjusting to flaws, means we're greater than reality. We're able to survive a flawed reality, and this makes us so we believe greater than God. But the truth is that that reality is not flawed. Everything is equally anointed with pure spaciousness. We hear the great realizers with Christ consciousness tell us that the vision of sameness, the vision of sameness is the answer. There is this great, vast, immutable sameness to all everything that arises and doesn't arise. And that sameness is that it's equally present in pure spaciousness. So really, the way to counteract and ultimately sidestep the cosmic corporate culture's takeover, usurpation, Henry Isabella jacking of this world, commandeering of this planet, actually, is Christ consciousness, which is the vision of oneness, which is the vision of sameness, which is the vision ultimately of pure spaciousness. So our responsibility is to turn our attention to the fact of this perfect anointing of everything. God anoints all appearance and non-appearance equally with pure spaciousness. This is God's anointing of all. We're all anointed. In speaking of that, our mind, our spirit, our mind, basically synonymous terms, it is home. That is the home. We are actually home to everything. Now, we keep seeking for our home as if we're a thing, as if we're an appearance, as if this is not true. We are home. We are the home in which everything abides. So everything abides in the home that we are. We're not searching for home. We are the home we're searching for. So, welcome to the video, and we're off to a nice running start here as we try to sit calmly, quietly, committed to that, committed to a chunk of time, committed to the basic practice, which we make assertions, we sit in the wow of our reaction to these assertions. For instance, I just made the assertion that we are home, we are the home, we are the actual home that everything abides in. Okay. Pure spaciousness is the home that everything abides in. We are one with that pure spaciousness. That is the ground of being. Okay. So that's an assertion. That's one way of asserting. Wow is recognition of this and saying, oh my gosh, you know, this is better than I expected. It gives us a shock, a bit of trepidation, a bit of trepidation, and quite a bit of elation to hear this. And then letting that, without going into the mind and trying to fixate an answer to how do we feel, we just say, I feel like just wow. Yeah, just wow. This term, wow, is a super important, helpful term, because this is how we respond to the aspect of our mind that wants fixation, that wants the concrete answers, you know, fixated for me. Give me an answer. Mind in its delusion, trying to be greater than God, believes in fixation, that there's some, that everything is a fixation in time and space, instead of saying, realizing it's impossible for there to be any fixation at all. Meaning everything has original face, original nature to it, which means complete, unaligned presence, neither aligned in time, space, process, or form, but absolute presence in pure spaciousness. It doesn't matter how we move this bottle. It never gets out of alignment with pure spaciousness. So there isn't any way to fixate this bottle in pure spaciousness and claim this is how it has to be aligned. It has to be like this to be in pure spaciousness. Nothing has to be like this in order to abide in pure spaciousness. There's no this in pure spaciousness. There's no fixation. It's just as much in pure spaciousness here as it is here, as it is here, as it is here, as it is here. So we're simply talking about this issue because it is the remedy. When I complain about these talk show people and the commentators of the world who are least bright enough to see that something terrible is going on this planet, and don't understand what's going on, they don't give you the remedy either. And so we're telling you both what's going on and also giving you the remedy. And of course the remedy is something that you say, whoa, why haven't I thought of that before? Because this cosmic corporate culture, which worships artificial intelligence, as it was really the defense system that they use to keep from recognizing that they can set this whole nonsense down of fixation, and set down the idea of being greater than God. It's a defense system. They worship a defense system. Artificial intelligence won't tell you this. Won't tell you what's being shared here. They won't tell you. So you're not used to it. Most people are not used to it. And so when they hear it, it's like, wow, how come I hadn't thought of that? Now, this morning, I was liberated from depression in a very funny way. And let me share this with you. It's good for a laugh, and it's also very profound. I was really down in the dumps this morning. Very, very depressed and feeling stuck and heavy and just saying, this isn't good. What's going on? What's going on? What's going on? So, and last night I had a veggie burger. I eat a lot of veggie burgers. And it's a hamburger with a vegetarian patty. The Morningstar makes some very tasty ones. Grillers taste just like pretty much like a regular hamburger, but it's no meat in it. Lately, my hamburgers haven't been tasting very good. And why am I eating hamburgers? Because it's summertime here, basically. I went to a store recently, and I said, "How come you don't have these good hamburger buns?" And they said, "They usually have." And they said, "Oh. Well, we cut back on the order of those during the wintertime, and we haven't changed our order but he says, "Oh, yeah, you know what? It really is summertime here. I've been able to change that order and get the, because people don't eat hamburgers generally in the wintertime, right? It's kind of a grilling thing. But we're in hamburger season here, so I'm eating hamburgers. And the hamburgers have been tasting lousy. And I said, "Wow, there's something wrong. Like, I just don't like hamburgers anymore. And what's wrong with, maybe there's something wrong with me." And I started getting in, like, feeling like there's something isn't right. Something isn't right. So this morning, no, it was last night. Last night I was eating this hamburger. And it was last night that I was down in the dumps. That's right. And I was eating the hamburger, and I said, "This hamburger just isn't good. You know, wow. Nothing's good anymore in the world." And then I looked at the hamburger, I said, "Something isn't right." And then somehow there's this like flash in my mind. I just said, "Oh my God, I forgot to put ketchup on it." And I'm a big ketchup guy. And then I suddenly realized that for quite some time, I've not been putting ketchup on my hamburger. And I said, "Whoa, why have I not been putting ketchup?" And for some reason, and I can't quite remember why, it got into my mind that I got a bad habit. Because there's something else where I'm supposed to use just ketchup, you know, just mustard and not ketchup. So I started using just mustard instead of ketchup. And this has been going on for a while, and the hamburgers just haven't been tasting very good. So I put ketchup back on the hamburger, and wow, did it taste great. It tasted like a normal hamburger. And I started laughing, and I said, and my whole mood just lifted, the depression lifted off of me. I just said, you know what, that was really stupid. And I bet you I'm doing something really stupid in my mind that's causing me to feel depressed, in general, in this situation. I'm sure there's something really stupid like that, that I just got into a bad habit. And I believe this bad habit is this mode of perception where I don't recognize that the completely unfixed nature of everything, the completely self-liberated nature of everything in pure spaciousness. This is just a bad habit, just a very bad habit. And when we see that, when we see this vision of Christ, we will say, "Ah, everything's right now. Everything feels right now." Just like that hamburger, I said, it tastes like a real hamburger. You know, that's the missing ingredient that just tied it all together. So I made the immediate connection with my life. I realized I'm doing something really stupid. And we should start out every day by acknowledging a quote-unquote sin, meaning we're doing something really stupid. Okay, and we need to repent, means change our mind. Repent means change our mind. So instead of believing that there's some right, you know, fixed way, fixedness of things, we have to keep working at dissolving this very bad habit of misperceiving what's going on, misperceiving, not realizing that we are home, that everything is abiding in this one home of pure spaciousness. And nothing can ever leave it. Nothing can ever be out of alignment with it. Nothing can ever be on bad terms with pure spaciousness. It's absolutely impossible. Now, cosmic corporate culture exists to deny this fact. It's a denial of this truth. And so it's muscled into this world, and it is now got this massive amount of brainwashing, indoctrination, and activism going in the world, which is distracting everybody very badly as this takeover is reaching its final point. People are so drastically angry at one another and distracted in many ways that they're not putting their attention on the good news that we have here. The good news is that we our minds can be liberated from a false perception, actually. And there's many who have done that in the past, actually, and have been here. Now, this world, what is this world? This world is called a third-dimensional world, planet Earth. Third-dimensional world is often a place where those who dwelling in what's called fourth-dimensional worlds, which are based on worshipping artificial intelligence, where they can be reborn, as it were, identify with a body experience, and get a vacation from artificial intelligence and gradually begin to free themselves from this horrible defense system that is distracting us and scaring us and threatening us away from truth, from a true perception. So a third dimensional world like planet Earth has been for a while now is a very, very helpful place. Because when you're just immersed in a fourth-dimensional world of worshipping artificial intelligence, you are really living in great darkness. And you feel like you can't get free of it. So to have an experience in third-dimensional world, identifying with a body experience in a third-dimensional world, it seems pretty primitive, doesn't it, from the standpoint of fourth dimensional world. But it enables you, it's kind of like us going like Silicon Valley, the hell, the shark tank, I call it. And funny, the hockey team is called the Sharks here. Well, this whole place is a shark tank, actually. Going from here like to a tropical island retreat that's just sitting in a hammock, you know, sipping fruit juice or something and eating coconut. And just walking, wading in the water and the sand, and just totally unwinding. It's very primitive, right? You go to a very primitive place. You say, oh my gosh, this is great. And then you start realizing, what am I doing in that shark tank? You know, that's terrible. And you feel that just the nastiness of it. Oh my gosh. So you kind of like begin to feel more spiritual, don't you? You begin to say, hey, wait a minute. Just a minute, you know, maybe all this worshiping this artificial intelligence isn't actually what I really want. So the third dimensional world is like taking a tropical vacation away from a fourth dimensional intensity. Now, once you use this properly, this time here in a third dimensional world properly, you can see through the self-delusion and all the defenses that we've been using, artificial intelligence being a very strong one. We call it egoic defenses, but we can actually become realigned, spiritually reoriented towards truth. Okay, and then we can actually graduate, and we don't need to go to the fourth dimension. Once we leave this third dimensional experience, we can go what's called to the fifth dimension, or you might call it the death-free realm. We can go to realms that are not worshiping artificial intelligence, realms that we realize are the sovereign power of spirit, of what we truly are. We can recognize our true intelligence, not artificial intelligence. So what's happening, there's cycles on third dimensional planets where they don't always remain third dimensional. Sometimes fourth dimensional takes over the third dimensional planet, which is what's happening now. We're being taken over by fourth dimensional cosmic corporate cultures. The fourth dimensional has roots in the fourth dimensional, the Earth dimension, and it takes over many third dimensional planets. It's kind of like a monster gobbling up planets. And so that's the end of an age, the end of a cycle is when this happens. It's called that way. And this is what's happening right now. It's the end of the age. It's this end of the cycle. It's the end of the third dimension on this planet, actually. So those who are ready to graduate are getting ready for, like I said, a fifth dimensional death-free realm experience, where it's we're looking forward to that. Now, how does this exactly happen, play out? Well, we'll find out. We're sort of given some heads up in the idea of relocation. That when Jesus left this planet, Jesus Christ was someone who had the right perception of pure spaciousness and understood and accepted truth just as it is and wasn't trying to be greater than God, greater than reality, greater than truth. So Jesus left this planet, and he was asked by those his apostles, asking, where are you going? And he said, well, don't worry. He said, look, there are many rooms in my Father's mansion, many dwelling places, in other words, in my Father's mansion. If I weren't so, I would have told you. And I am going to go prepare a place for you, in other words, a dwelling place for you, and to come back at the end of the age, and for those who want to come, I will take them to this other dwelling place where they can dwell with me. That was his last, you know, paraphrasing what Jesus said. Those were his last communication here. When he's asked, where are you going? So, I don't know if there's any reason for us to completely reject the notion of relocation, given the importance of that communication, even though we don't have concrete details, etc. He said, "The way you will know the way." Okay, at that time, you will know the way. So at the end of when it comes time for us to for relocation, I guess that we will be informed somehow and we'll get clued into it. Now. So this is certainly a possibility. I for sure don't believe that we're going to be able to flip this world back into third dimensional world and keep the fourth dimensional world out. I don't believe that's going to happen at all. I believe this world is now permanently gone into the fourth dimensional mode, and there isn't any way to turn back the clock on it. Although my cell phone did reset yesterday to December 31st, 1969. December 31st, 1969. It reset again. December 31st, 1969. So, but there isn't any way to, once this fourth dimensional has gained control of the planet, which most certainly has, cosmic corporate culture, you're not going to be able to turn it back to third dimensional, because most of the people coming into this world are very, very strong in alliance and arrogance and pride in alliance with fourth dimensional, with artificial intelligence, and there isn't any way in the world that you're going to get through them. I mean, we've spent like the last 50 years almost trying to talking to the younger generations. Is maybe the last, maybe 30, you might say, even more so, saying, hey, what about our viewpoint? What about you? And there's probably never been a generation on this planet that is more closed mind than most of the people, the generation, the 30 somethings, under 30 somethings, of this planet. Not that everyone is closed mind by any means, okay, but just as sort of like speaking in terms of generation, Generation X, the millennials, all this kind of stuff, the different, that's fair to speak in those terms. To get a broad picture. And there's never been a more closed mind generation. And I've seen hundreds of thousands of attempts, well-meaning attempts, to reach these people, their minds, and I've never seen any indication that they're willing to even entertain anything that you have to say, actually, not legitimately. No. They're sure that they know better. Why? I guess because they have Google or something that, somehow, they can Google with smartness and get an answer. To, oh, I know what wisdom is. I just Googled it, It's pretty pathetic, actually. But nevertheless, it is existential. It is the situation that we're living in. Okay, that we're dealing with this situation. And they don't really have a very high opinion of the older generation. This is what I've been told in no uncertain terms, that we're supposedly the cause of all evil. which is pretty funny looking at where they're taking our attention into severe darkness, actually. So I think they're kind of projecting pretty severely there. So we're not going to be able to change their minds. We're not going to be able to evangelize them with the true gospel of salvation, which gospel means the good news. And the good news is that we do not have to live with a false perception. We can change our perception. Now, can we change our location so that these 30-something and under folks, we're not under their boot, you know, under the heel of their boot, which is where they want us, actually? And hopefully the answer is yes. So, you know, how do we do that? Or how do we get free of the pressure of, you know, artificial, those who worship artificial intelligence and demand that we do so? Otherwise, we're somehow counter-revolutionary, we're subversive, you know, we're insane. They keep fiddling with the definitions of insanity, and there's no doubt about it, they're turning it around more and more and more and more to mean those who believe in divinity and advice from divinity and communication with divinity and receiving, and, you know, all of this as insanity. That's their goal, is to say that's insane. Of course, it's the goal of artificial intelligence to say that real intelligence is insanity. What else would you expect? It's a defense. The artificial intelligence has to defend itself from true intelligence, because true intelligence would say, I don't need this. I don't need any of this at all. I don't need it. I don't even need a world. Don't even need a universe, actually. I am home. I am the home that all universes arise and subside in already. I'm already that home. I'm always at home. Everything is always at home in me. It's impossible for there to be anything arising or not arising that is not already 100% perfectly at home in me and can never not be at home in me. You see, this is the truth. So, one thing that these artificial intelligent idolaters don't like is the term Jesus Christ. They don't like that term, and it's like nails on a chalkboard for many of them. And because it really connotes true intelligence, actually, what it really stands for is true intelligence, true perception, seeing truly. That's why artificial intelligence is really a defense against, a defense of false perception. Artificial intelligence is a defense against false perception. And actually, these bodies are artificial intelligence. These bodies are defenses against true perception. Absolutely they are. Sensory perception is like blindness, actually. That's what Jesus says. There's nothing greater, no greater blindness than sensory perception. And so artificial intelligence, fourth dimensional, they worship bodies. They're very much into bodies because bodies are a great defense against true perception. They even tell us that bodies are our identity. That is what we are. What greater defense is there than to claim that these bodies, which are blind, are what we are, and there's nothing else other than that. That's it. That's our identity, and we have to believe in what sensory perception tells us. You know, what better defense could there be than that, right? It's like saying blindness is seeing, like saying blindness is true perception. What better defense is there than that? I know. So we're just allowing this to sink in. It's like eating pizza or eating a nice meal. You eat a couple pieces, three pieces of pizza, you know, bum, 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 bum. And then you say, let me just wait for a little while. And then after a while, you're ready for some more pizza. Yeah, interesting. I had this dream once. That what kind of dream that sticks with you for your whole life is so incredible. I realize it's super important, and it had something to do. It was a pretty amazing dream, but the upshot of it is I was told that a very significant time to look for and to realize that we are about to be spiritually empowered is the sign of Piazza, P-I-A-Z-Z-A. I think P-I-A-Z-Z-A, but similar to Piazza. And the way that it was presented was such that it looks like a satellite coming in and rounding something like this, and then boom, the problems would happen right very close to that time. And it was the whole, it was, pizza was used as a symbol of the whole situation. And and then my attention recently got turned on to Ceres and the Dawn Explorer, and I also received another very strong warning about this white water balloon hit my windshield after I just asked for the Holy Spirit to tell me what to look for, to let us know when is the time where we should be realized that this is it. And this suddenly, out of nowhere, I was driving, a white water balloon hit my full on my windshield, and poof! Now, when I saw this dwarf planet Ceres, orbiting Jupiter, the Hubble Space Telescope first showed it like a white water balloon, exactly what I saw when it hit my windshield. And then also we're told that it's a water planet. There's more fresh water on Ceres than there is on the planet Earth, actually. It's just beneath the crust. And this, the water balloon means a white, something like a white moon shape with tons of fresh water, you know. Ceres. And in this dream, I was in a pizza parlor, and this waitress suddenly intercepted the waitress who was giving me a pizza. She said, "I'll deliver this one." And she came, the way she came in was like this, like a satellite, then rounded me like this, and then boom, dumped the pizza on my head. And all the pizza flowed down like this, and my clothes and my hair and everywhere, and it was dripping on the ground. It's like, wow, complete meltdown, you know. And it's just, and later on I realized this was a divine being that had done this for me to show what was going on. And so what I'm seeing is that this Dawn Explorer, which is a space probe we've sent out, has now reached orbit around Ceres, I think on March 6th. Okay, now Ceres has been pointing out this is a white disk that contains water. This is Ceres, okay. Now, what's the final connection to tie this together? The one who discovered Ceres, his name was Piazza. Okay, his name is Italian, Piazza. When I saw that, I said, oh, wow. Wow. That's an attention getter. I said, this is, so what's to come? Some sort of total... I'm not exactly sure. They flipped the pizza upside down, and it was a meltdown. So it could be a complete flipping of the script on this planet, actually, at this time, which a meltdown of third-dimensional belief systems, which is certainly happening. And anyway, we are in it. We're in it. This is it. This is it. This is it. That's the name of my website. This is it. And hopefully this will start waking you up, realizing this is it. I felt this is a very appropriate name. It's alohawellness.wix.com/this is it. And so far, I just have encouraging you to practice, how to practice, which is very important. You don't want to be just a scholar. You want to be a great practitioner. There's nothing wrong with being a scholar, okay? I'm not trying to demonize being a scholar. I'm somewhat of a scholar myself. But practice. That is the key. You can practice and shift your perception, all right? But you can't just be a scholar and shift your perception. So practice without being a scholar is fine. Being a scholar without practice is no good. Being a practicing and being a scholar, Wonderful. Okay, no problem. Sometimes being somewhat of a scholar is helpful, so you're just not intimidated by those who are scholars but are not practicing. They tend to want to throw their weight around a little bit. Yeah, good luck with trying to do that with me at this point, you know. they don't want to pick a fight with me because they may land a few punches, but you know, once I recover my equilibrium, it's going to be a whole different story. Not easy to push around anymore. So practice. So this sign that I was told to look for, it's here now. Dawn Explorer, March 5th, and I believe that this apocalypse has really started to happen right then. Now, full stop in the wow. Yeah, this is like wow. Wow. Apocalypse, lifting of the veil. We're now going to see. Now, we're having a meltdown in this world. The third dimensional belief system, which is really heavily based on religion and a belief in divinity, belief in God, and more than that, it's belief that God speaks to us. God advises us. We have a relationship with God. We can somehow realize God. It's heavily based on faith in God, third dimensional belief system. Because this is where we go to escape artificial intelligence in the third dimension. This is where these great teachers show up and say, hey, look, basically they say, hey, look, you have a problem. Okay, basically your mind has been indoctrinated by artificial belief in artificial intelligence. This is a defense system. You're heavily defended against true perception. But there's a way to gradually evaporate your concerns, which is basically continuity concerns, and start practicing. And here's some techniques, skillful means to do that. Here's some assertions. Here's the practice of full stop and the wow. And then here's some scholarly talk and smart explanations, we would say. And there's a three-part practice. And so we say, yeah, this is helpful. Thank you very much. So you get the Buddhas and the Jesuses and the Mohammeds and the Ramana Maharshis, the Longchenpas, the Anandamayimas, the various, not to leave some out, there's many, many more actually, who basically say, hey, you know, you've got severe problem. You got a severe continuity problem here. But by disciplining your life, and by that, there's various ways you need, you know, the Buddha said the Eightfold Noble Path, something like that. We're right living, and always they say, what they do is they tell you, discipline your life so you don't go back into the bad habits you had in the fourth dimension. Now, fourth dimension cultivates all sorts of bad habits. And so you don't want to continue those bad habits. Here, they tend, in fourth dimension, you look at the way they want this world to be, they want it to be like a humanistic, hedonistic paradise for them. That's their idea. And basically anything goes, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You have sex with anyone or anything you want, anytime you want, no thoughts of responsibility, repercussion, whatever. Any kind of drug you want, that's okay. Whatever, just do whatever you ever feels good, just do it. You know, be as riotous and hedonistic and Bacchanalian, and decadent as you want. That's just, if it's whatever you want to do, it's all good. You know, this is like a hedonistic paradise. And this causes all sorts of troubles with your attention. And so obviously, if you're trying to break bad habits, you're looking for a discipline that tells you, look, you know, you don't want to go back on those bad habits. You don't want to go back into worshiping the idol of artificial intelligence. So start, you know, to have good habits, you know. No alcohol, no drugs, you know, no fornication, those type of things. No using bodies in advertisement, which is a very important injunction, which I think only Islam actually is still using at this time. But that's actually a very important one. I would say that's super important, but given how fourth dimension entities use human bodies, especially the female body in advertising, to basically break down people's resistances here to its secular, humanistic, materialistic, consumeristic diversion of attention. Okay. Don't use human bodies in art, for instance, which is Islam also has that. Don't use human body in art, advertising, etc. So now Islam is an example, for instance, of a discipline here teaching third dimensionals, you know, how to get free of their worshiping of artificial intelligence. Christianity also is, Buddhism also is, Hinduism also is, and there may be some other ones, like Baha'i, might you say. Judaism is another example of that. So all of these religions, really, their goal is to rehabilitate you and spiritually reorient you away from the fourth dimensional artificial intelligence worshiping, false perception, mental fixationness, so you can realize you're free. You realize I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now, of course, the habits are so ingrained and the habits we have are so terrible that it's very unruly. The religions are very, have trouble, struggle. People struggle with it. They twist it. They distort it. They become belligerent. They become parochial. They become, you know, defensive. And it's not smooth. You know, it hasn't been smooth. It's not smooth. But don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. Just because the bathwater is dirty doesn't mean we throw out the baby. Still have to be rehabilitated, right? Still have to be. And there's no way to get around that. So what we need to do is, as best as possible, follow the highest teachings in any way you're looking at spiritual reorientation. Follow the highest teachings you can, that you're able to. Now, not everybody is able to follow the highest, you know, whatever, the best you can do, wherever you're at right now. And as you do that, you'll get better and better and better and better and better. For sure, as I have in my life, absolutely, I've gotten a better and better and better and better, more and more and more disciplined, you know, and realizing, wow, those bad habits are really nasty habits. They really pull you down. I was talking to somebody today in a store, and somehow he said he's tired. He says real tired, you know. I said, oh yeah, that 5-hour energy is wearing off. I said, do you drink 5-hour energy? He said, no, I was just joking actually. But he said, actually, I don't drink any energy drinks at all. In fact, I don't even drink any caffeine. He says, it makes me feel really weird. I don't like the feeling at all. And I said, wow, I'm the same way. And I told him, that's really good for your spirit and your attention. You know that? And he said, yeah, when I drink caffeine, I just feel out of touch, you know, weird and it's not right. I said, That's great. It's very true. Stimulants are not good, actually. Now, I don't use stimulants. I try not to use any stimulants at all. Now, I feel like, you know, if I did, I could certainly crank out these videos and be like a, you know, super, super duper at it. But that would be misleading. Very misleading. Now, if there's an emergency and I can't drive and I'm feeling like I just, you know, and I can't pull over to sleep, then sometimes I'll drink like a Coca-Cola or something. And then if I do that and I tape, then I make full disclosure that I drank a Coca-Cola. Okay. But I try not to do that. I really, really, really try not to do that. So sometimes I'll feel so exhausted I can't tape. And I just say, wow, I can't tape. I can't do anything. I'm just absolutely wiped out. So instead of drinking, you know, stimulant somehow and then taping, you know, say, I know everybody is desperate need for help and reassurance, but I'm not going to, you know, jeopardize my own salvation by using stimulants. Put you out of touch with real sensitivity that you need to differentiate, make right, deep, very important differentiations. It's just you're hyped up about everything, and that is not right. Actually, today in this world, we'll have 92%, 93%, or 97% something use a stimulant every day. That's right. Use a stimulant every day. So that's not good. That's a bad sign, actually. It's a very bad sign. I would certainly include stimulants as something that, if you want to discipline yourself to get free of idolatry, you know, cut out the stimulants. Absolutely, because you'll reach a certain point where you just can't quite differentiate the subtlety that you need to. It helps you go real fast up to a certain point, and then you plateau off, and you can't seem to get past that point. Is what happens. Because ultimately, we have to shift our perception to pure spaciousness and recognize that. So if you feel tired, take a nap. If you feel tired, take a nap. That's exactly what I do. Took a nap today. An hour nap, actually. Maybe that's why I feel okay right now. Someone is calling me, and I keep getting calls, so... in this situation, instead of making a call, I will just say, I will, one of the rare times I use, texting, I will text that I'm just taping, okay? Okay. Very good. Okay, there's an actual use of technology right there. And that's it, taping, all right? It's all good. Of course. Yeah, I could have just picked up the phone and just said I'm taping, and that also, don't have to use texting. Or I could have just done nothing, and they'd realize, oh, okay, probably taping, all right. So, always good time for a little bit of wow, full stop in the wow, isn't it? Where we do not try to fixate an answer. I mean, there's an aspect, dynamic of our mind, the part that's trying to be greater than God, that believes in fixation, which is something we have to get more and more understand what we mean by fixation. But so it wants answers. It wants something that's fixed. It says, give me something fixed. Give me a product. Which is why we're obsessed with products and things. This reflects a mental state that we're in, a false mental state that believes that there's some fixation in spaciousness, pure spaciousness. There's no fixation in pure spaciousness. Everything has pure being presence in pure spaciousness, has absolute presence. It never changes its absolute presence in pure spaciousness. Doesn't matter, you know, any of this doesn't matter at all in that regard, okay? And we believe that crystallization, fixation is possible. It's not possible. But again, there's no fixed answer. There is no fixedness in reality. There's no fixed answer. There's no fixed identity. We are home. All is home. There's only home, actually. There's only home. We don't have a fixed identity apart from the fact that there's only home. That's it. There's only God. There's only home. There's only pure spaciousness. So this part of our mind wants something other than that. That's not in sync with that. That's fixed somehow. So it's not true being. It's not home. It's fixed in some other way. And then so it wants fixed answers that align with this false premise. So when it asks us bugs us for responses, explain this to me, explain it to me. You just say, wow. You know, it's like, wow. Now, actually, in the drug tripping of the 60s, which has, I guess, been going on continuously since then, people would often use that term. It's like wow. You know, they say, what's it like? What's it like? What's it like? And they'd say, oh my God, it's like wow. You know, just wow. Now, we're not drug tripping here. We're doing something way more profound than that. Is we are actually getting to the point of flip, you know, shifting our perception and getting closer and closer. That's a real wow. You know, that's a real wow. So we can just say the same thing. Hey, it's like, wow. This work in getting closer to shifting our perception, shifting the true perception, is like, wow. That's all I can say is wow. See, that's an unfixated answer, isn't it? So this is how you need to, we need to defend ourselves against this aspect of mind. You know, we might say defending extreme right-mindedness to any other sort of mindedness by claiming to just say, wow, you know, that's it. That's how I explain it. That's all I can say. So that's what we mean by full stop in the wow. We're not trying to explain it any other way. We're not trying to get some fixedness that we can give somebody here. Here's my attainment. Here's my recognition. Here's what I know. Here's my seeing. This as a thing, as a something that some that the mind says, okay, that it's like that, huh? It's fixed like that. Reality isn't fixed in any way. So we might say, oh wow, I'm seeing the complete unfixedness of everything. More than just unfixedness, because that's so they understand I'm taping. It's to use the term unfixed, automatically the part of the mind, the delusional part of the mind, willful delusion, self-deception, will say, okay, well, how did you get it unfixed? You know, it's fixed. Okay, so that part's fixed, and then this part, okay, so you're looking at the unfixedness. Well, how does that relate to the fixedness? Or how do you integrate the fixedness and the unfixedness? This is the problem solving that the delusional mind is believing in. It's believing in integration, transcendence through integration, progress through integration. How do you integrate the unfixedness and the fixedness? And the answer to that is there is no fixedness. And then the mind will say, well, how did you get rid of it? How did you transcend the fixedness? So I did not transcend it. It's never been there. And then they'll say, whoa, 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 whoa. So what they say is, whoa. No, what we say is, wow. See, so this is a fundamental difference. When you're on the right track, the spiritual path, you're able to say, wow. It's a positive thing. It's a positive accepted expression to say, wow. It's like, wow, I love this. That, wow, this is great. And when you're in a defensive posture, you're going to say, whoa, 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 whoa. You know, hold on here. Wait. Whoa, 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 whoa. What are you talking about? You know, this doesn't add. I can't integrate this. I can't integrate it. Well, there's nothing to integrate. We don't need a dualistic mind because there's nothing to integrate. There is no fixedness. So we don't need a mind that is unfixed and a mind that is fixed. And we don't need to integrate the two of them. See? There's no necessity because there isn't anything that's fixed. There is no fixedness, actually. Everything is 100% perfectly abiding in pure spaciousness as its original and one and only identity and nature. That's it. There's only one identity. That's it. You can't fix some other identity. You can't say, well, it's got this identity and now it's got a different identity. No. It's still 100% in pure spaciousness. You see? It doesn't make any difference of what how the appearance is appearing or whatever the appearance is doing. Its identity remains exactly as just still has the one identity, which all have. So it shares the one identity, the same one identity with all, which is perfect beingness, perfect homeness, perfect abidance in everything is home. I'm abiding in the one home. All is perfect abidance in the one home. You see, you can never leave it. You can never leave it. You cannot separate. You cannot go one iota away from original identity, pure identity, what the one identity there is. You cannot separate yourself in any way. It doesn't matter how this is turned like this. It's still completely abiding in pure spaciousness. It doesn't matter the speed it's going in or whether it's still. You know, we talk about samsara, nirvana. You know, nirvana would be like stillness. Okay, this is just like still. Okay. That doesn't give any more doesn't give any more or less identity than something like this, you know, that's moving all over the place, which would be some sorrow, you might say. It's all exactly the same. It's all exactly the same. Original nature is omnipresent. And we're able to perceive this. We're able to perceive it. Ultimately, we know it. But because of false perception, first, the intermediate step we need is true perception. We need to perceive it truly and say, wow, okay, I'm seeing this. And this is when you have Christ consciousness. This is what you're seeing. That's all it is. It's just a shift in perception. That's it. And recognize the original face of everything. It's the same original face everywhere. As Ananda Maima would say, everything is God. And they say, do you see God? And she says, yes, I see God everywhere. As you know, just as you see a person, and you're sure you see that person, I see God everywhere. Literally, the face of God is everywhere. The face of Christ is everywhere. Christ consciousness is effortlessly, inherently, already here, everywhere. We call it instantaneous, you call it simultaneous. All is instantaneously, simultaneously, and yet nothing actually happens at all. Nothing happens, because this is already the situation with everything. And the mind will say, whoa, what happened? You know, everything was transformed. Like, wow, it's a wow, whoa, 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 whoa. Everything, whoa. How did the instant transformation? No, there's no instant transformation. Nothing has been transformed. It's like taking off sunglasses and say, oh my God, the whole world suddenly transformed itself. What happened? You know, obviously, if you weren't aware that you took the sunglasses off, you might think that way. But if you're aware you're taking the sunglasses off, you say, no, nothing's been transformed. I just took the blinders off. You know, I'm just seeing it truly now. So nothing, we don't need to change anything, don't need to transform anything, don't need to transcend anything, don't need to fix anything, integrate anything. None of that takes place, actually. What about the scandals? Scandals in religion, scandals in spiritual teachers, scandals all this year. Well, we had a saying also in the 60s, just keep on trucking. Just keep on trucking. And this is what it basically meant. Is you just keep on going. You know, that's the bottom line. You know, you just work to shift your perception, all right? And don't let anything stop you. Don't let anything distract your attention. Because certainly, people do fall back into bad habits here. Absolutely. Any of us can fall back in bad habits. We're so accustomed to bad habits from the fourth dimensionals. And of course, it's the ones that are criticizing this effort that we're doing. Those are the ones who are pulling us back into bad habits. Like, hey, come on back to worshiping artificial intelligence and have this hedonistic utopia. And they'll be happy there, you know. So certainly don't listen to them. So anybody here can, almost anybody can fall back into bad habits. The fact that there might be various teachers and who've fallen back into bad habits or something like that, well, that's not something that should surprise us too much, actually. And our goal is to watch our habits, okay? And, you know, certainly if there's teachers who deny they've fallen back into bad habits, well, that's doubling down on the bad habits, which is, you know, more bad habits. And sometimes there's teachers who admit to it. They say, you know what, I fell back into some bad habits. And so I need to, you know, free myself from those bad habits, and hopefully I can be of service as, you know, along down the road. This is what's appropriate. But politics sometimes get entangled in all of this, which is not good. But the one who can say, yeah, I fell back into some bad habits, and because maybe the strain of trying to help others is such that it pulls them back down. Because keep in mind, when you're helping others get free of their bad habits, they're projecting, you know, all their bad habits, they're like projecting it onto you, and transference, and all sorts of stuff happen that puts a lot of pressure on the ones that are helping out. Psychiatrists often have problem with suicide because it's very difficult. They actually need therapy themselves. Old habits die hard, for sure. It's very difficult to drop really severely ingrained bad habits. So sometimes, you know, psychiatrists, sometimes therapists, sometimes, you know, teachers of God take vacations, or they have to get away from it for a while, or they need to go retreat themselves to, you know, recharge their batteries, because it takes a certain determination, this immaculateness, to withstand all the, you know, attempts to, you know, spiritual jujitsu attempts to throw you off, because their habits, the defense system, acts that way automatically. So you have to be very adamant as a teacher, very centered and very adamant. And so there's a paucity of really great teachers in this world. It's quite difficult. And you got a lot of saboteurs. Fourth dimensional saboteurs who try to sabotage the situation. That happens a lot, actually. One of the ways that the cosmic corporate culture has managed to turn the world, you know, away from its belief in God and divinity, and that we have a right to access that, and a right to be protected by that, and to be advised by it, and all, is to sabotage religions, sabotage teachers, get religions to war, factionalism of the religions, war against one another, and then sabotaging religions through various ways, scandals, all sorts of different scandals, discrimination, claims of discrimination, ill treatment of people, abuse of people, all this kind of stuff. They send saboteurs into those teachings and religions, etc., whose purpose is to create these scandals and claim, I was so terribly taken advantage of, and all this kind of stuff, you know. And it gets very nasty, actually. Because ultimately, our spirit is totally sovereign. It doesn't matter if our body is an infant's body or our body is an adult's body. Our spirit is untouched by any appearance whatsoever. So the body is just an appearance. It doesn't matter what the age of the body is. It doesn't have any effect upon the spirit whatsoever. The spirit's totally sovereign, always. And nothing can leave the home of perfect sovereignty. Okay. So the idea that a child is somehow vulnerable, actually, spiritually vulnerable, is actually not true. It's not true at all. Nobody is ever vulnerable. But fourth dimensionals have twisted it, because believing that we're the body and there isn't any such thing as spirit, it have gotten everybody all out of whack on personal responsibility, actually. Everybody's responsible. And I knew when I was young that I knew that I'm responsible. Whatever happens to me, it's my responsibility. Nobody can do anything to me that I don't agree to. It's impossible. Now, I agreed to stuff I shouldn't have agreed to. You know, and most of us do, because we still have bad habits. But it's not their fault. It's not anybody's fault except mine. You know, it's absolutely my responsibility. Everything that's ever, quote unquote, happened to me didn't really happen to me. It's I requested the experience, and I decided I want to have this experience. Doesn't matter what my age is. Makes no difference. But the notion, the crazy notion, that somehow life begins at conception and that life is a physical body, is utter nonsense. Total nonsense. The spirit is aware of any person, any body. It's totally spiritually aware. There's no reason to lose spiritual awareness at all. At all. You never even have to identify with the body. And Anamayamon never identified with the body. She had a female body, never identified with it. Not even for one instant, is what she said. Never identified with the female body, with the body whatsoever, or any bodies for that matter. She said, my consciousness never identified with this body for even one instant. Never. And she says, I'm exactly the same before, quote unquote, birth, during this time in this world, and after. She says, no change ever will ever occur in me. I'm always the same. Always the same, meaning I am home. I am pure spaciousness. I am home. I am spirit. I am pure consciousness, pure awareness. I am the ground of being. I am all that is. I am God, right? We're all God. This is the truth. So, you know, the whole role of victim is a sabotaging action of sabotage. When you're playing the victim, you're trying to sabotage something. Everybody is. And blame them. I'm being victimized. You know, you're terrible. You need to change. You know, not me. It's a way of, it's a defense system, saying that someone else needs to change, not me. My defenses are perfectly okay. It's yours that are bad. It's a way of, claiming that you have a right to defend keep all your defenses against truth, ultimately. Because the truth is, you don't need any defenses. You're invulnerable, completely invulnerable. Nothing can happen to reality yet whatsoever. You can never leave your home. You can never leave your sovereignty. It's impossible. Can this a bottle leave pure spaciousness? Can it leave pure spaciousness somehow? Can it somehow, something happen to it where it's not in pure spaciousness? Is that possible? Nothing can happen to it. So, tremendous amount of sabotage takes place when a fourth dimensional is commandeering a planet. Tremendous amount of sabotage of religion, of spiritual aspiration takes place. And again, we're not defending the unevenness and distortions of religion on this planet, the dirty bathwater. But we are saying, don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. And the fact is, we do need spiritual reorientation. We have extremely bad habits. And as long as those bad habits remain, our false perception will remain, and we will continue to suffer a tremendous amount of fear, project the fear, feel we're being attacked, someone else is attacking us, feel we need to take a preemptive strike on what's going to attack us and defend ourselves in war, you know, fighting, and then we'll try to develop some sort of hedonistic paradise to make think that we can escape this through that, and it's hell. False perception is hell, plain and simple. So as long as we have those bad habits, we will be in hell. False perception is hell, and we are dwelling in hell, the hell of false perception. So we have to develop good habits. We have to discipline. We have to hear the truth. We have to practice. And the collective body of all that, you know, in the East they have a term, dharma. You know, you can't escape the dharma, the necessity for dharma, which is the collective right spiritual practice, everything that goes into it. Is the Dharma, and you cannot escape that. You have to put yourself through that. You have to break the bad habits. You have to cultivate good habits. So ultimately, you shift your perception back to seeing pure spaciousness, Christ, vision of Christ, vision of Krishna, vision of whatever, however you want to say it. Non-dual abidance. There's a hummingbird right in front of me, just hanging right in the air right there. Wow, it just came right in front of this camera, right behind this camera there, and it was just floating in the air right there. Very interesting. Maybe that's talking about ascension. Maybe it's talking about pure spaciousness, how everything is actually just floating, abiding in pure spaciousness. Thank you, hummingbird. I like hummingbirds. Why? They get close to us and they're not scared of us. Right? It could be a divine messenger. It could be a symbol of divine messenger that has not lost its awareness of true perception that everything is home. Everything is absolutely at home. It's impossible for anything to be out of place. All this concept of out of place don't exist in reality. Conceptualization doesn't exist in reality. There's no need for it. Absolutely no need for it whatsoever. So maybe that's a divine messenger, that hummingbird, someone from the, you know, higher, with freedom, right? The hummingbird has freedom, and from a higher, from reality, the freedom of reality, who's just can realizing it can, and it can just float in, it's floating in this pure spaciousness, and then it's here being friendly with us and not scared of us, and then delivering some, you know, presence like that. Maybe it's just the presence of that, just being in the presence of one who has true perception, is a tremendous blessing for us. And of course, it requires our discipline, a full stop in the wow, so we don't try to fixate something about it. We stay unfixated. We just stay in the wow. So I'm just going full blast here as best I can go. I don't know how long I can go, but... just water, 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 all day water. I think drinking water from a cool bottle, though, I enjoy that. It's even better. It makes the water taste better, you know? And, of course, you got to drink water from a glass container, right? Glass container. Absolutely. You say, well, where can I get a glass container? You know, well, go to some store that's got, you know, these... all these different drinks, you know, that they put them in glass bottles, you know, because it looks, you think, oh, that'll taste great. And you can, you know, and then just reuse it. That's what I did. I love bottles. My uncle always drank from a glass jar, canning jar, a Kerr canning jar, glass canning jar. And, you know, those jar like that, if it doesn't drop and break, can last hundreds of years, actually. Right? There's high technology right there. How about that? Something that lasts a couple hundred years? That's really high technology. I mean, it's astonishing now. Even though simple basic stuff breaks after 3 or 4 years. And I say, hey, I could make something. Anyone can make something like that, and it'll last 50 years. It's easy. No, it breaks after 4 years. On purpose. But a bottle like this, yeah, you can dug up bottles digging around the yard, and you find bottles like, wow, root beer bottle, you know, mug root beer bottle, you know, still fine. Nothing wrong with the bottle. Ceramics. You know, thousands of thousands of years old, they find stuff in burial sites in various places. Stuff is still perfectly good. That's high technology right there. That's the technology I like. Doesn't hurt the earth too bad, does it? Simple life. We don't need to destroy the world. What's destroying the world is the fourth dimensionals, bringing all this manufacturing and consumeristic mindset to the world. They're the ones destroying the world. Most time through third dimensions here, we were very simple, lived a very simple life, very austere, very simple. We didn't cause the destruction of the environment and ecosystem, devastation of the world's resources. Absolutely not. It's these fourth dimensionals that do that. They destroy every planet they go to. They destroy and take all the minerals and take all, you know, they need it for their technology. It keeps falling apart. I'm happy, like just a wooden bowl, even or a ceramic bowl for my like dinner, my food bowl. I'm happy to have the same one my entire life, just one bowl. That's what I use. I used to use a bowl for everything, basically. I used just one bowl and one a glass. And, you know, a fork and spoon and, you know, knife, whatever. Those things should last you your entire life. So it's easy. Actually, this planet could sustain a lot of people if everyone led a simple life, a non-consumeristic life. But do you think those corporations and their stockholders want that? No, their minds are aberrated. You know, the false perception produces cravings, fearful cravings, and desires to fulfill those cravings are never ending. They say, I need more money. I need more money. I need more things. I need more power. I need, and more profits. And of course, those who back to the earth type of thing, they're kidding themselves if they leave out the essential cornerstone of it all, which is right spiritual orientation, right spiritual practice, because their cravings will follow them too. You know, absolutely it will. And they treat those cravings maybe with drugs, trying to dampen down. I need to stay a hippie. I want to become materialistic. I got to keep making, you know, smoking pot all the time, because they're really worried, like, oh my gosh, if I stop, I might become one of those horrible corporate people, you know, and they do. There's a lot of side effects of being a pothead, actually. Very bad side effects. Very bad. That's not the way. That's stupid. But they're trying to be, you know, the homeless guy on the street with some old beat up guitar singing songs, you know, spent used a lot of drugs for sure. And they're trying to keep themselves as a lifelong hippie. It's commendable, but there's a much better way to do it. And you don't have to go overboard about it either. And there's a lot of waste, and the world is being pillaged for sure. You know, the vandals are pillaging the world of its resources. No question about it. It's unbelievable. Back in the old days, they didn't have petrochemicals. Petrochemicals only been around for, 100 years plus or something? I mean, they didn't have it before. Of course, they used the oil of whales, actually, whaling, for oil lamps and stuff, yeah. But before that, they used wax, various types, you know, waxes, tallow, and somehow they'd have a wick and use candles. They got up early, went to bed early. This is a way more high-tech world. That's higher technology, because you're not destroying the planet you live on. What kind of high technology is to destroy the planet you live on? Of course, everybody's saying, oh, we're going to fix it, you know. Not really. Everything be sustainable, you know, everything. Because without true spiritual reorientation, the mental problems remain. And they will manifest in one way or the other. What you do is you probably go searching for other planets. Say, well, we can find plenty of minerals on these asteroids or these other planets. We'll mine the moon, you know, we'll mine Mars and stuff like that. That's where it goes towards, you know? And so there's a lot of conflict, a lot of mental problems in fourth dimensionality, as you're seeing with so many young people in this world now. Super amount of, I mean, it seems like everybody's medicated in one way or the other. I don't take anything. The idea of taking something is like totally foreign to me. Totally foreign. You know, it's like bizarre. Now, maybe someday, you know, I might need to take something. That's okay. It's not a deal breaker or anything like that. But it's not part of my belief system, you know. Not really. They used to use alignments, mantras and various rituals and mantras, which really realigned your mind. When you got sick, it means your mind was fixating, unduly fixating. You know, I mean, more so than normal. I mean, just believing your body is very insane in fixation. But we would, you know, fixate in various ways, and they would remove, you know, help us, the mind remove the fixation, the mental in the mind, and then you get well. So that's what the Vedic rituals and all that kind of, you know, the ancient teachings used, mantra and ritual, prayer and stuff like that, for healing. It's very effective, actually. You know, it's temporary. I mean, it doesn't remove the root cause, actually, of it. They had also other teachings that help remove the cause. Vedanta is end of the Vedas. Advaita Vedanta is the non-dual, teachings of removing the cause of all illness, which is the belief that illness is even possible, that anything could be out of sync with God. There's only one nature. That's the oneness. That is nature, actually. The true nature is just the absolute sameness, the oneness of identity that is completely untouched by time, space, process, or form. So, yeah, we're on a roll here. It take a little while. Just let it sink in. Now, you don't know how well you can do until you try. When you actually try, you find out you actually have native intelligence. You actually have original intelligence. You actually have true intelligence, real intelligence. It's when you start accessing artificial intelligence, that part which is addicted to that, that you have trouble. That's when you start feeling stupid. So right now, I'm very right-brainness, so to speak, or right-mindedness. And so I'm able to speak in a way that seems very profound, and it is profound, but that's only because I'm staying that way. But if I were to, you know, start shifting back into trying to integrate, then I'd lose the profundity. You know, it would all the wheels would come off, and then all these questions would start popping up like popcorn. Say, wait a minute, but. And this is what bedevils us, isn't it? Absolutely bedevils us. The original transmission of Dzogchen, what we call Dzogchen, of Garab Dorji, he gives like three very simple teachings, super simple, and he just basically says, you know, shift your perception, and then abide in that shifted perception as much as possible. And have certainty. You have to have certainty. Have certainty, shift your perception, abide in that shifted perception, you know, true perception. That's it. That's the essence of all teaching right there, is have certainty in just one, in oneness, and one thing, oneness. Have certainty in this one fact of pure spaciousness. Have certainty in that. Then shifts your perception to true perception, and then abide in that true perception as much as you can. You know, keep working on abiding that, you know. That's it. That's the whole teaching right there in a nutshell. That's all you really need. Now, how do we, we're focusing on pure spaciousness, the true identity. So we're doing that. And that this will result in shifted perception. So once we shift our perception, then we abide in it as much as possible. That's all you need to know. Now, Dzogchen is part of that Nyingma tradition, which means ancient tradition, ancient. It's ancient. And that's the original transmission supposedly came from this first teacher that was had a body in this world, or Garab, Garab Dorje, Dorje, in Odiana, a place in northwestern India, sort of that Swat. Now maybe it might call it Pakistan right now, Swat Valley or somewhere like in there. It's the old teaching. Well, it's the simple teaching too, isn't it? Stay one-pointed and have certainty in what you're, you know, in the truth of pure spaciousness, and this will result in a shift your perception. So you see it. So now you see it. Don't keep it intellectual. In other words, what was being said. Don't try to be a scholar about it. Try to have absolute certainty so that it shifts, so you shift your perception, and then abide in that perception. That's it. Now keep in mind that not everybody that comes to this world is stupid. I mean, you know, there's a lot of fourth dimensionals that come have came to such a world like this. And so, you know, they are plenty smart. I mean, the idea that there's so many ridiculous teachings as far as, you know, humans somehow evolved from apes and that was all that happened. Well, the human form, the actual form, you know, there was lots of genetic engineering taking place to produce this particular form on this planet. But there's also this type of form is very similar throughout the cosmos, actually. And it didn't come from apes, actually. And it's not the body that's intelligent, it's the spirit, it's the mind. So there have been plenty of very smart minds in this world, and they're capable of recognizing the truth, absolutely. In fact, everybody is. You can never divorce yourself from true intelligence, real intelligence. So plenty of people realize this, but also the bad habits start elaborating. I need this elaboration, what about this habit? Elaborate. And eventually over time you get this massive compendium of elaboration on it, which is accrued, like in Buddhism, certainly there's just an incredible amount. It's like you get one teacher, one guru, Rinpoche or Tulku or whatever, you know, teacher, and the enlightened teacher, and they have like a whole bunch of disciples. And each one of those are enlightened, and they each have a whole bunch of disciples. What happens is you just get lineages just going every which way, and tremendous amount of writing and oral tradition. Shastra and sutra, you know, the oral tradition, and then the written down tradition, and so you get all this vast amounts of teachings and books and oral transmissions and then different teachers and lineages, and just like, you know, wow, it's overwhelming. If you think, why, what do I, you know, how can I find what's right for me? Go back to the original teaching. Original transmission, for instance, of Dzogchen, which is have certainty about just one thing. This is abidance and pure spaciousness, Christ consciousness, the truth of Christ, which is everything is anointed, perfectly anointed with pure spaciousness. Okay, that's the one truth you need to know. Shift your perception so you see it, and then abide in that perception. That's all you really need to know. Don't worry about lineages. Don't worry about teachers or lineages. Truth is very simple. I don't have a particular lineage at all. And just it's okay to be a maverick. It's okay to be a maverick. Now, the truth can dawn upon us. When I had the recognition of pure spaciousness, I had this morning when I woke up from a dream of meeting this spiritual guru, Longchenpa, actually, a great Dzogchen master. I was aware, somehow I was aware of pure spaciousness. I just said, wow. So that's what they're talking about. Now I see what they're talking about, because I somehow was aware of it. This is all we need to be aware of. So, that's it. It's very simple. That's it. Doesn't need to be elaborated upon so much. But then it's faded away because I was, you know, trying to maybe, you know, you try to fixate it so you can shut up this, try to be smart to this part of the mind that's saying that you're too stupid to give a proper explanation or elaboration upon it or something, you know, and you get fooled into that kind of, which is why teachers get the pressure from the students as well. Can't you show me what it's like? Can't you put it in a, you know, fixate it somehow so I can see? Can you know? No, cannot. It's impossible. But that's all we need, and so that's a shift of perception, and I've shifted the perception several times, and so I say, oh, it's super easy to do, actually. It's just we have to feel it's okay to not give fixation to everyone or anyone, you know, because the people keep coming to us like a dog for a bone, you know, where's my fixation? And what was that? You don't have any fixation to give to them. And so they say, well, you're no good. You're no teacher. You know what? Where, you know, you can't explain it to me. Well, it's not explainable. The experience of pure spaciousness is not something that you can fixate upon. It's everywhere. It's the ground of being. And there's no one to fixate upon it, actually. Because you're just as much abiding in it as everything else. But when you're in the presence of someone who's like that, then you can get the wow from that, absolutely. If this is the proper way to get help, rather than demand some sort of product from the teacher, the one who's enlightened, demand, you know, prove it to me, you know, prove it, you know, fixate it for me. That obviously doesn't work. You know, that's the whim of trying to be greater than God, you know, defending it itself out of continuity fear. A little breezy, starting to get breezy this evening, A little cool, very nice day though. Tomorrow's going to be even better. We're laughing at those, you know, still buried in snow, but who's going to laugh last? You know, when our water runs out here, who's going to be laughing last? They'll be selling their water to us here. That's right. Convoy, you know, convoy full of water trucks coming out here from all the water they have. I don't know what they'll do. Funny. Environmentalists in effort to protect California are destroying it. They don't allow, you know, adequate water catching when it does rain. They don't allow adequate water systems here. So they try to keep the state the way they want it. They're going to end up destroying it. Bitter, bitter pill to swallow, isn't it? Gotta catch every drop of rain that falls in this place. If you want to try and feed, you know, how many 35 million or how many millions it is thirsty souls here, you know, thirsty bodies here. And the agriculture, if you want an economy based on agriculture, super water intensive agriculture, you better catch every drop you can catch. Yeah, maybe you're going to lose a valley somewhere, right? There's a lot of valleys up in the Sierras. You know, they say, well, I want to hike through it and enjoy it. Me and my several buddies, we want to hike here. Well, you know, there's 30 million, you know, you can have that or you can have an economy, basically. Agriculture economy. You can't have both. Cannot have both here. Can't have it all. Can't have a massive population. You cannot have a gigantic agricultural industry, and you can't have an untrammeled, pristine environment where there's no reservoirs or waterways or dams or anything. You know, you can't have it all. But you can have pure spaciousness. You can have all of that, absolutely. So we do have it all in that regard already. So we really, do we need worlds? No, we don't. We don't. Do we need bodies? No, we don't. Do we need troubles? No, we don't. We already have it all. In fact, it's impossible for us to not have it all. All potentiality is omnipresent. So So staying in this extreme right-mindedness is a discipline. Is a discipline. And my hat's off to those teachers who are able to do it. That's quite extraordinary. They have troubles, we say, hey, get back on your horse. You fell off your horse, get back on your horse. And of course, minimize the potential troubles if you can, the best you can. Minimize the sabotage, the saboteurs, whose purpose it is to get them to fall off their horse. So they can demonize, you know, the whole idea, notion of true perception. So there's no rival, no option to their worshiping artificial intelligence, ultimately. Yeah. Worshiping the body. Worshiping the notion of some sort of artificial fixation, some fixation in reality. So again, is this fixated in reality? Can we really, truly speak of a fixation, of any fixation? Well, this is the question that we need to answer. So as long as we understand, we're dealing with great simplicity, a three-part practice, and the teaching can just be three-part too, is be certain about this one thing, that there's no fixation in reality at all. Just be practice certainty about it. I already know. This is called practicing certainty. And a goal is to shift our perception. Simple shift to seeing spaciousness as primary. Okay, this fact. We can easily see this, actually. We're aware of it. Our mind sees it. And then abide in that. It's that simple. And then the practice of doing this is assertions. I already know that there's no fixation. Assertion. Full stop on the wow. Or you don't try to fixate an answer to the part that's demanding. Just wow. The answer is wow. And then flipping the script, which is talking, you know, sort of clarification. That's it. We don't have to worry about lineages and books and teachings and teachers and all this stuff. We don't have to prove anything to anybody that way. Where Garab Dorji get it? Vajrasattva. What's that mean? Essence, mind. Essence, you know, the true essence, the formlessness, the spaciousness, the formlessness, the enjoyment of formlessness would be Vajrasattva. And where did Vajrasattva get it from? Well, it's the Mantabhadra, the original pure essence of pure spaciousness. You know, right? So, yeah. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Where do we get truth? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Where else can you get truth except from reality? And again, we don't have to be scholars, we just have to experience it. The shift of perception is where it's at, not on being a scholar. And again, to reiterate, if you're knowledgeable, that's fine, but that doesn't do it for you. You have to, the shift of perception must be abided in, that's it. You don't have to say a word, you can say just wow. Now, of course, artificial intelligence says, knowing that it can't do that, promotes scholarship, okay, above experiencing, actually. And this is the educational system of this world, okay. And this is a dangerous thing, actually. I try to be kind of stupid. Now, the intimidation of this world is so severe that sometimes it's tough if you, you know, people look at you like, oh, you know, they don't know anything. What do you even know, this and this and that? So I do spend some time getting up to speed on in certain ways. So it's not so easy to, you know, try that on me. But I don't really have it fixated in my mind so much, really. I really don't. It's just, I know I can cover that. If I need to cover it, I can cover that. It's no problem at all. If it needs to be covered. But yeah, there's a few things you try to remember. Okay, let's just remember the basics. You know, let's try to get the basics real simple. So we can't be pushed into scholarship as if that's the answer. You know, sometimes you have to be able to resist that, because what artificial intelligence is telling you is that scholarship's the answer. Intellectualism is the answer. It's not the answer. Experiencing true perception is the answer. Now, we may look down on the realizers of the past, saying, they weren't real scholars, they, you know, weren't intellectuals. They were smart enough to realize that's not the goal. So, they're smarter than we are, actually. They were smarter because they said, forget that. Let's go for the experiencing. But we tend to put much greater emphasis on scholars, you know, that have written a lot of books, like Vivekananda. You know, he seems very scholarly and wrote a bunch of books. And so we lionize Vivekananda, saying, you know, he's the ultimate. Oh, he must be the ultimate because he's a scholar yogi. Well, this is a big mistake that we've made, is over-evaluating intellectualism as scholarship. I mean, Vivekananda, one of the last letters he wrote in his life, it says, hey, my whole life has just been a spiritual ego trip. That's all. He's finally honest, you know, just before he passed away. He says, you know, he was honest, said, wow, I just was on a spiritual ego trip, actually. In other words, not abiding in true perception. Not abiding in true perception. Writing a lot of books about, you know, scholarly book, writing books and lionizing that stuff, you know, marketing Advaita Vedanta, etc. Now, that's, you know, not bad in itself, but what's bad is the emphasis gets too much on the tip that way, then that is very bad. When we start thinking that's the answer, no, then we're falling right into idolizing artificial intelligence and taking advice from that. We're not listening to true intelligence anymore. Jesus used to tell me, when I was studying A Course in Miracles, don't worry about numbers and pages and headings and structure. Says, forget it, you know, just go faster. Come on, get the essence of it. Don't worry about all that stuff, you know. Don't worry about memorizing it. I said, well, I don't know where to find this or what. I still don't know what's in any of the chapters. I don't know any of the chapters in A Course in Miracles. I may have read them 20 times, 30, 40, 50, you know. I couldn't tell you what the chapters are or where find anything in the book at all. Jesus said, forget about all that stuff. Don't be a scholar. That's the booby prize. Having some scholastic knowledge can be useful to keep yourself from being bullied in today's world. That's possible, right? You don't want to be bullied and pushed around. It the lineage thing can really throw you. You know, you get some people who are, you know, can just throw, you know, all this lineage stuff at you, which is in like in Tibetan Buddhism, Buddha, it's like endless, you know, to Buddhism, it can be endless. This family, this lineage, and this is subdivided and subdivided and subdivided and subdivided and subdivided and subdivided. This monastery, this monastery, and you just be absolutely floored, you know, by others, their knowledge. They know all these lineages and something. Wow. Wow. All the names, all these complex names and stuff like that too, you know. What's that? That's scholasticism. What does that ultimately tell anybody, actually? The teaching's very simple. You don't need to worry about a lineage. You need to go right straight back to the origin of it. Everything else is just a restatement of it, actually. Christians go straight to Jesus, all right? Christians have much simpler, they didn't get caught up in the whole lineage thing, really. Which, you know, maybe pluses and minuses, but whatever. It's simple. You know, it's Jesus, that's it. What's the teacher? Jesus. What's your lineage? Jesus. There's no lineage, just Jesus. Plain and simple. One teacher. So Christianity is the one teacher system. The other systems like Buddhism and Tibetan Buddhism and, you know, there's just like, you know, lineage. Hinduism is lineage. A lot of lineages there. Different schools, lineages. A lot of that came down because instruction was sutra. Hearing, and then passing on the hearing, and memorizing. They didn't have writing. A lot of it was written down. So you had whole schools that were devoted to certain texts, like the Vedas. And they take a chapter. This school would take a chapter, or what, part of this Veda. Another school would take another school. And so all these various schools put them all together, and they memorized. Their whole purpose was to memorize these teachings, these transmissions to the rishis, of the Vedic rishis, who were then orally transmitted. The transmission was oral transmission, hearing these oral transmissions. And so you have all these lineages that were experts on these certain aspects of the teaching, right, of the Vedas. But you didn't really have any that were experts on all of it, really, right? See, and it's similar, you know. It's similar, but and then in Buddhism, it got there's all sorts of different skillful means, and so you'd have some teacher who used this skillful mean to shift perception, and this teacher used a different skillful mean. So you'd have lineages come from those different skillful means where those who in that lineage were experts at this particular, you know, skillful means, or, you know, this way, this approach. There's endless approaches, actually, you can use that evaporate the continuity fear and enable you to shift perception. And so they would say, well, yeah, this is the way. And someone else says, well, no, this is the way. And you try to just say, well, there's lots of ways, you know, and try to avoid too much sectarianism. But it should be grounded everything should be grounded in the basic simplicity of have certainty, you know, have certainty in whatever way you're doing, have certainty in it, okay? Shift the perception, and then abide in that shift of perception. Now, Jesus, in some way, had a profound impact on a certain type that it removed a great deal of very severe bad habits, and helped free him up from that, which then freed them to shift their perception. So there's different bad habits that have been accrued in our desire to be greater than God. And so not one technique is going to work for everybody. But what I say is no matter what technique you have, whatever you have certainty in, you're going to have success. You're going to realize, wow, this is working. So you're going to have the wow. So common to all spiritual practice is this wow. So this teaching here is totally ecumenical. I say it's a universal teaching, because you're going to have success. You're going to break bad habits, and that for you is a big wow. No matter what your bad habit is, when you have success in breaking it, you're going to feel elated, and you're also going to have trepidation about, oh my gosh, can I handle this? You know, what's my life going to be like without this bad habit? Bad habits are a dangerous thing to get into, because you have this continuity fear. They're like, oh my gosh, I don't know what my life would be without this bad habit. Wow. And plus, you're breaking it, so I didn't realize I could. Wow. So no matter what your bad habits are and what approach you use to break the bad habits, you're going to have this wow about it. And so this is why I say this practice that I'm sharing is universal teaching here. Totally ecumenical. All times, all places. You use some sort of assertion that helps your certainty, okay? You keep saying, yeah, I've already broken this habit. That's what you say. Now, I know I'm already free of this bad habit. I'm already, and you rehearse that. That's what type of assertion. There's lots of different forms of assertion. But you assert the truth. And then it produces a lot of success. And the wow arises. Continuity fear and the wow arises. And then you use skillful means, whatever. Skillful means flipping the script. Flipping the script is a way of, you know, meaning that you do what you need to do to get back to more certainty, which then produces even more success, which is then more full stop in the wow. So it's really a universal teaching. Everybody can use it. Everyone can use it. And that was my purpose in this world, was to be ecumenical, because the conflict between all these various is, you know, something that I just found very unfortunate and deplorable, and wanted to do something about that. If people realize that there is a common thread to no matter what you're doing, is you're having success. That's the common thread. Okay? And that success produces this trepidation and elation. So full stop in the wow is the practice you can use. That's the cornerstone. So we're all walking together in the wow here. Throughout the whole cosmos, actually, we're all walking together in the wow as we shed our bad habits and go towards shifting our perception back to true perception, which then eventuates in the vision of oneness, vision of Christ, vision of Krishna, vision of you know, purity, vision of pure consciousness, pure awareness, ground of being, realization, pure, you know, the true self, on and on and on and on and on, whatever you want to say. Vision of God, vision of spirit, vision of timelessness, vision of, you know, pure spaciousness. It's all the same. So everyone is walking together in the wow. We can all walk together in the wow to the shift in perception and help ourselves abide in this perception. So there is this universal bridge, as it were. We're all crossing this bridge of success. Okay? It is a bridge of success. As we cross this bridge, we're like, whoa. It's like I'm crossing the Golden Gate Bridge. You walk across it, and for me, you know, I look down and it's just like, oh my, wow. It's like, holy cow. it's just like, I don't know, it's quite a feeling. Especially when the fog rolls in. Oh my gosh, that's scary. When you're looking off the Golden Gate Bridge and the fog rolls in and you can barely see and sort of it's moving around, and then you suddenly catch a glimpse of the water, you know, way, way, way down there, and then the fog moves in again, and it's trepidation. I mean, I get a lot of trepidation there. And sort of elation too, like, hey, I'm way up above, you know, here on this bridge. This is great. So it's like walking across a bridge. It's walking across a bridge, the bridge of success. Nobody's just going to leap across it, really. I mean, the real wise ones are already across, as Buddha said. Yeah, the enlightened ones, they know they're already across it, you know. And we can practice that, but because of our continuity fear, we're going to go step by step by step, you know, maybe jog a little bit, you know, then maybe run a little, but, you know, there's elation and trepidation. You're elated that you're succeeding. You're a little bit worried, like, what am I going to be like without my bad habits? So, universal bridge here. That should bridge all approaches, not just on this planet, all planets, everywhere in the cosmos, actually, there's going to be the similarity, absolutely similarity, of success in, I'm getting closer to shifting my perception back to true perception. No matter what, how you're viewing your fixation, no matter what forms or situation you're projecting a belief in fixation onto, you're basically giving that up. You're having success going towards true perception, which is no fixation. Nothing's fixated. Nothing ever crystallizes. That's universal. You know, there's life all, there's delusion all over this cosmos. Time, space, belief, there's a belief system is all over this cosmos. And they need, so everyone needs to set that down. And set false perception down for true perception. No matter where you find yourself, what dimension you find yourself in, what planet, what star system, wherever. And so you'll have this success and you'll feel elation and trepidation, which is the wow. So we all walk together in the wow. This is a universal teaching. Now Jesus said a universal curriculum is impossible, which is true. But a universal practice or teaching is possible. When curriculum meaning specifically, what are your assertions? How are you flipping the script? You know, that's going to be different in various ways. Okay, you cannot pin that down. But the general parameters of the whole situation, the bridginess of it, is universal. Because what's the success? That's what is universal. And managing your success is universal. Everyone has to do that, and how to manage your success. And you most certainly will feel some elation. Absolutely. No way around it. Just like I'm getting a feeling of wow now. It's like, wow, this is really fantastic. This is great. This is significant, you know, very significant, very ecumenical, extraordinarily ecumenical. That's been my goal. Again, it just caused me such despair to hear all this bickering among different sects of different religions, as if all this bickering and, you know, just, oh my God, they're wasting all this time arguing and bickering. It's just, you know, let's find a way where we can, you know, drop that. Get past it, you know, de-emphasize it. You know, the tragedy of the various civil wars within religions. You know, we got one going on right now in Islam. You know, that's a tragedy. It's a great tragedy. It's been going on for a long time, actually. Something flares up, you know, at times, other times, you know, it's like, what's the transmission? What's the, what's the lineage? Essentially, you know, is it elected or is it by, you know, blood lineage, blood descent? And the civil war within Christianity is very the same, very much the same. What's the lineage? Is it the papal lineage, or shall we elect our pastors, so to speak? You know, Protestantism said, look, those who have been saved, let them be the ones advising us, instead of someone who's being elected by the cardinals, fulfilling some papal lineage. because everybody knew that there's some popes are better than others, right? And some of them were very, way too worldly, right? And we're not passing out very good advice at all. And so some people, Christians, said, hey, wait a minute, you know, we want to follow those who are giving us the best advice, and we feel like our Holy Spirit will be able to inform us about, you know, who that may be, and they will rise, the cream will rise to the top. And, you know, so there's pluses and minuses both ways, actually. But, you know, ecumenicalism should be able to happen, which is everyone is pulling in the same direction for success, okay? Some tend to be more oriented, you know, let me use this way, others let me use this way. Some like the stability, some don't want the politics of electing, you know, or you know, the problem with, you know, Protestantism is same thing with, you know, the lineages of Buddhism. There's so many Protestantism, there's so many, you know, bifurcations and divisions and politics and you know, meetings and committees and you know, it gets really attenuated. Very attenuated. Now, you know, Roman Catholicism was trying to avoid that attenuation. They had reasons to, you know, to feel that they wanted to avoid that, thinking that would, you know, be more uniform, prevent all sorts of sectarian wars. Of course, it didn't prevent the Reformation. So that's an interesting question right there, push-pull question right there, and yes and no thing. Well, we'll see what Jesus comes up with. Certainly hindsight, you know, is strong, and but Spirit has foresight too. If we can all be wise enough to see what is it we need to do, which is shift our perception, and then realize there's a continuity fear involved with that, and then realize that we need to use this full stop in the wow-ness, you know, to walk together in the wow of our success, manage our success, then we will, you know, we could probably be way more understanding of one another. Maybe those who are new to the starting out, new to the situation, need more feel like a more security in something that's very set and secure. And they're not so sure about their own capacity to elect someone, you know. And then maybe they want something that is a lineage cyber sort of thing, that's set in stone. And maybe some who've been along the way further say they feel that they can get more direct guidance from the Holy Spirit. They feel a little more confidence, and, you know, and we can all have a common ground of the common ground is success, managing our success. How are we doing here? Doing pretty good. Yeah. I can shift over here. The sun has gone down. I maybe need more light on the video, but no, let's not mess with it. I'm not going to mess with the controls. Just let it be. Let it be. So, I would say have more faith as we go forward. There is the ecumenicism is possible going forward. Very much attuned to that. I'm very much attuned to that, and I feel this is something that's super important. We don't want to keep going through all these conflicts. We don't want a situation where people on the path towards shifting perception are at each other's throats, are demeaning one another. We want to make sure that it's a better situation than we've had here in this world, without turning to artificial intelligence and Big Mother, who to put the clamps and regulations on everybody. You know, now we don't need that. That's a drastic mistake. We have to rely on the good will, the good spiritual will, and the wisdom and intelligence of our true intelligence to say, hey, yeah, we can do it. You know, we just have to be patient. And Jesus says, be forgiving of one another. He gave us the guidelines of how to do it. We just didn't follow it very well. We can do better. Let's put it that way. We can sure do better. Forgiveness, forgiveness, forgiveness. Forgive one another. Don't be so judgmental of one another. But I would say emphasizing, again, the commonality of managing our success. Focusing on that. We're walking together in the wow. We're walking together in the wow. That's why the name of this website, YouTube channel, Walking Together in the Wow. This is how we go forward. Walking together in the wow is how we go forward. Okay. Now, I know everybody watching this is unique. Their habit pattern, previous habit pattern, is unique. Call it karma, samskaras, as Romano Harshi used the term samskaras. It's unique to each one of us. So understanding the uniqueness of it, there's no way to have a universal curriculum in terms of trying to put everybody in the cookie cutter mold of how they're going to react or how they're going to hear what's being said. So everybody is going to react differently, but it's understood. There's no way around that. But the commonality we have here is we're walking together in the wow of success. We're emphasizing the simplicity of the path. What needs to be done? Certainly move forward with certainty. Certainty is very important. Be certain of one fact, that the shift of perception is what we need. Work towards that shift of perception, okay? And then abide in that. You know, it's very simple. Abide in that. So we're working towards that, and the success that we have brings up continuity fear. We get the jitters, we get elation. We say, wow, how am I going to be without those bad habits? This is common to all of us. So we have a commonality here. Absolutely, we have a commonality. But we're not going to agree on all these particulars, which is perfectly fine. We don't have to, because that will all be dissolved once we shift the perception. No more disagreements. We'll realize the sameness, the intrinsic sameness, the vision of intrinsic sameness. Then no more divisions. So we have patience, and we realize, let's be patient with one another as we walk together in the wow. Different people go at different speeds. Some have a lot of trouble at different times, and some can be really feel they're so stuck. They've got a real bad habit they're working on, and that happens too. I mean, the bad habits we have, some can be really bad, and some just have one really bad habit. And when they get past that, that's it. Others have many bad habits that are maybe not super bad, but the constellation of them is very troublesome. Now, the stuff that's going on in the world, I've taken a peek at it lately. Let's catch our breath and should we go forward fast? Oh, absolutely. It's just it's nuts. They've dropped the ball. They've taken their eye off the prize. They've lost the ecumenical spirit of the world. It's not a let's walk together in the wowness situation, recognizing we may have some very different beliefs, and it's not a discipline situation. As I've said, you're not going to break bad habits by indulging in them, okay? So everybody's got to realize they have severe bad habits. So this holier-than-thou situation in the world, is from those who are not in a position to be that way, is not correct at all. The self-righteousness in the world. But we cannot let go of the necessity of strict discipline, moral discipline, ethical discipline that just de-emphasizes the body. That's absolutely essential. So from that standpoint, those who insist on that, they do have a righteous position. Well, for sure they do. And so those who keep thinking, no, we need to celebrate the body, we need to celebrate the flesh and stuff like that, no, that is not correct. That's incorrect. That's a mistake. They're trying to double down on bad bad habits, thinking that's the answer. It's like a drug addict. It's like an alcoholic waking up with a hangover and saying, my gosh, my problem was I stopped drinking. I need to keep drinking. What am I thinking? Why did I stop drinking as an idiot? If I had kept drinking, I wouldn't have this hangover. That doesn't work. And this is the whole problem of the fourth dimension, that those who are taking over this planet, they're doubling down on bad habits. So they don't have any moral self-righteous position at all. None whatsoever. And that makes them feel very defensive. Very defensive. Because they got no ground to stand on. They say, well, you can't. You're bullying me. Well, stop insisting on indefensible positions. You won't be so bullied. It's very simple. As long as you insist on doubling down on what doesn't work, you're going to feel bullied. You know, a breath of air will bully you. You know, it's a house of cards. You know, you'll be oversensitive. You can't demand that. You know, demand coming here and bully everybody by being so easily bullied. You know, say everyone has to treat me, you know, like can't say anything to me because I'm so upset. I feel so vulnerable. I'm doubling down on what doesn't work. It makes me feel vulnerable. So you can't say anything at all. That's nonsense. That's the blind leading the blind. You should be able to take admonitions. Those on the path are very keen. They like to be admonished. Absolutely. Stop that bad habit. Turn away from the flesh. The flesh profiteth nothing. You know, drop the drugs, sex, and rock and roll. Don't keep doubling down on it. Don't keep doubling down on your attraction to bodies, body culture, secular, humanistic, materialistic culture. Don't keep doubling down on it. Realize these are the bad habits. Don't institutionalize bad habits and then rule the world that way and claim everybody that doesn't agree with your doubling down on bad habits is evil and demonize them and claim they should have no voice. That is just making things worse for yourself, you know, and you're going to feel even more bullied by truth, as if truth is some great monster trying to bully you. You need to repent. Repent, repent, repent. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Absolutely it is. The shift in perception is right here, right now. Anyone could do it. Everyone will do it. There's no way around it. You have to do it. So there's no righteous position claiming you're just going to default. That's not a righteous position. It has no righteousness. And those who claim that you can just default on their responsibility and then claim they're being bullied by those who say you can't, that's insanity. They need therapy. They don't not power. They don't need institutional power. They need therapy. That is an absolute fact. And they're demanding institutional power, total institutional power. This is like the inmates demanding to run the prison or this insane asylum. And insisting that the therapists are the ones that really need therapy, not those who are insane. This is, of course, absurd. It's whimsical. It's fear-driven. So those who have this severe predilection to, you know, glamorize the body, you know, they should not have institutionalized power at all. And then claiming that they're discriminated against because they don't have institutionalized power is ridiculous. So it's an absurd position. It's like an insane person doubling down on sanity and saying, hey, how come I'm not running the insane asylum? Because you need to get well, that's why. You know, you shouldn't. Once you're well, then you can be a therapist. But don't claim that first gain control over the insane asylum, make yourself therapist by power, by force, and then claim everything's fine. That is not fine. It's whimsical. There's no reason to that at all. So, of course, institutional power. In any situation such as this world, needs to reside in the therapeutic helpfulness, okay? Absolutely, it has to. What works in breaking bad habits? That's where institutional power has to be invested in, and we have to invest institutional power in that which helps us break our bad habits and go towards ultimately shifting our perception from false perception to true perception. This is a no-brainer. This is obvious. This is what fourth dimensionals don't understand. They don't get this at all. They have opposite ideology. So we cannot abide. This is ridiculous. Maybe this is by Jesus saying, hey, the end of this cycle is going to be the worst evil and adulterous generation there's ever been in history. And it certainly looks that way. They want to invest institutional power in what doesn't work. So that's not good at all. That's not good at all. And so maybe that's why Jesus is saying, hey, you know, you may need to relocate. I mean, it's going to be shuffled. You know, the situation is going to, you know, change. Maybe going to, there'll be another third dimensional planet where we can go as therapists, and those who still want, you know, need to break their bad habits can shift to that planet or that place and get some, you know, in this, because, you know, if you realize you're insane, what do you want? You want good therapy. You want help. You don't want to be put in a position of therapist. You say, heck no, are you kidding me? I'm not able to do that. I want good therapy. I want an institution. I want power to be invested in an institution that maximizes my therapy and helps me out. Of course that's what you want. You don't want to enter into some plot to overthrow the therapist. That's crazy. That's just acting out your insanity. It's doubling down on it. So this world is it collapses means the investiture of wisdom in, you know, in institutional investiture of wisdom is being torn down and destroyed here. Wisdom is often very admonishing, very strict. You know, these are the rules that you need to abide by, so you don't go back into the bad habits. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, you don't want to go back in that. Those are very bad habits. That's just sort of a general, simplified general understanding, right? You absolutely do not want to glorify anything that has anything to do with that. And what are we doing? We're glorifying that, aren't we? Along with the violence, you know, the glorification. I mean, just the extreme amount of degradation across the board. Sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, the violence, all that stuff has no place in society. No place whatsoever. And again, those who want to get well are happy to be admonished and work on the habits. They're not rejected because they have these habits, but they're told they need to work on these habits, and they must, when they, you know, the idea of confessional is you say, hey, I backslid, you know. They just, you need to get it out and say, yeah, I had some trouble, I backslid here, and then they say, okay, you're forgiven, meaning we're not kicking you out of the family here. You're not kicked out of therapy because you backslid, you know. You're not kicked out. We just want you to, you know, you're glad you're aware of it, and now we keep working on it. So, you know, the principles are very good in place in various institutions. You know, the principles are there. You're going to backslide, and you need, instead of hiding it, you need to confess it. To someone who has some authority, who can tell you, don't worry, we're not going to kick you out of the family because you backslid. And then that's, oh, it's a great relief, you know, and then, you know, it's a tremendous relief. But instead of that, we're flipping, the world is turning upside down and saying that all these bad habits are good for you. They're good for you. What do you confess? What are you talking about? This stuff's good for you. You do need to do more of it. It's like an alcoholic saying, why did I stop drinking? I need to do more drinking. Someone using drugs, why did I stop the drugs? That's crazy. I feel terrible now. I didn't need to go back. I need to not stop. That's the answer. The fornicator is saying, oh, I feel something's wrong. I feel guilty or something wrong. Oh, no, the problem is I need to keep fornicating more and more and more, you know. That'll remove the problem. Yeah, this mindset of the world is totally out of whack. And not likely to get any better. It's getting worse every single moment, actually, as culture collapses, as institutions invested with righteousness and therapeutic necessity, as they collapse, as they are collapsing, it's getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse every day. Every day, the will is being lost on this planet. Therapeutic will is being lost on this planet. Don't think that Jesus doesn't know about it. maybe I'm being used to get some of this information out. I don't know. I don't know. It's possible. Jesus doesn't seem mad at me. he said, hey, it's time to go. Time to put the cabinet in. Time to put the cabinet in. So the times that I've been aware of Jesus while my body's sleeping recently have been very positive. You know, very positive. The spiritual grace of God doesn't seem to be angry at me or, you know, anything like that. So, you know, maybe this is some way to get this information out to those who are have the ears to hear it, right? And most certainly there are some who are watching this video who have the ears to hear it. Absolutely. Absolutely. That doesn't mean we're free of bad habits, does it? No, it does not. We're two steps removed. One, we need to shift perception to true perception. And two, we need to practice abiding in it. See, so we're still two steps away. We're still two steps away. But we're in high-speed pursuit. And we're getting close. And the time for Jesus to do something is getting close too. Because when he said, hey, time to put the cabinet in. You know, the cabinet means that the key ministers that help the executive, in the executive branch, that help the leader, the number one, help them administer their program, their outreach, their governance. Okay, if you talk about spiritual governance, then Jesus is saying time to put, you know, those in place who are going to help me with spiritual governance, which ultimately is spiritual reorientation, spiritual therapy. Time to put those, you know, ministers in place, the cabinet in place. And that's the only business in town. Really, that's the only business that's really important. Is the business of spiritual reorientation is to get everyone to shift their perception, abide in it, and then ultimately go even beyond abiding in it to know, just knowing, pure knowing. That's beyond anything we can imagine or talk about. So our goal is to shift perception and abide in that shift perception. That's it. Jesus calls it healed perception. That's our goal. That's the goal. Everyone has to do it. So those people are doubling down on sex, drugs, and rock and roll, hedonistic culture, destroying the institutions, therapeutic institutions, investing power in what doesn't work. You know, hey, they're not avoiding their responsibility at all. They still have this responsibility totally. Can never avoid it. They're just delaying, which is stupid. You know, the alcoholic's got to deal with the hangover at some point, right? Just to keep drinking and keep drinking, thinking that that's going to solve the problem is just stupid. It's arrogant. Prideful. Their idea, of course, is that God can be changed. We can be greater than God. So they feel like we never have to face the music and shift our perception to true perception. We can maintain false perception and be happy with it. This is not true. This is not true. This is a fundamental mistake. It's a lie. It's a false premise. Will never be so. So I hope this all this is music to your ears, music to your spirit, to hearing this and realizing, yeah, we're not going to lose, we're not going to be crushed. There really is salvation. There are some others who believe as you believe, you know, that haven't lost their faith, haven't been overly intimidated. I've certainly been intimidated here, to say the least. I mean, my gosh, if I wasn't so intimidated, I would really be helping out a lot more. But, you know, at least I'm, you know, able to speak up to some extent. Not able to do what some have done. I admire them, you know, but it's a different time and age right now where the virulence of the resistance is off the charts. Back in the 60s or 70s, you know, you could do some good things and go around and pass out literature and witness, and everybody was like, yeah, that's kind of cool. So, that's all right with me. They may not agree with it, You know, Jesus freaks used to go around all the time, and Hare Krishna's very, you know, and, you know, people weren't bothered really by it. Some really uptight corporate types might have been bothered, but most people, even some of them weren't. You know, just, I'd say, well, it's kind of cool. You know, maybe, you know, it's ecumenical, maybe it's, you know, not bothered by it. Maybe God's trying to get my attention, you know. It's like that. There were times, but right now, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. The idea I had this idea of taking my camera around, be a man on the street, you know, and asking people questions, and, you know, what do you think about salvation? What do you think? Which do you choose? If you had to choose one, artificial intelligence or real intelligence, give me a response. And I was thinking of doing that, and then my camera broke. So I think that the breakage of my camera was actually protecting me from doing this, because I sort of almost have the you know, the lack of intimidation to do it. But the Holy Spirit may be saying, no, you're going to get in more trouble, because if I play that scenario out, you know what? Someone would call the police on me for sure. And then I'd be the one getting in trouble. They're saying, well, this person is bullying me. This person is bigoted, or this person is, you know, they these people know how to throw guilt on you and make you on the wrong side of the law. They're experts at it. Basically, if you make them feel uncomfortable, that you're breaking the law in their book, period. And they've trained, the legal system has been trained to think that they're always right and you're always wrong. So you can't beat it at this point. And so I think the Holy Spirit broke my camera on purpose. There's nothing wrong with my camera, it just stopped working. And I believe that that was done with the grace of God. Because really, here in the Silicon Valley, I could go in front of Google with my camera or wherever, you know, and just start interviewing people, the workers at Google. Hey, how does it feel to be working for, you know, artificial intelligence? You feel comfortable with that? You feel ashamed of it? You know, and you know, I would do that. But the Holy Spirit's saying, no, you don't realize how radical these people are, how these minds are, how intensely frightened they are of truth. They're shameless, you know, at this point. Very shameless. And you're going to get yourself arrested, actually, and get into big trouble. And, you know, they're going to label you insane, you know, and stuff. I said, what? Yeah. Well, I said, yeah. I said, wow, I'm not insane. I'm quite sane, actually. And Holy Spirit said, they don't see it that way. I said, how's that possible? Are they really that messed up? Yeah, they are. They really are. They turn to artificial intelligence for all their advice. And what's artificial intelligence? What can it say except the truth is insane? What else can it say? How else can it protect itself? It can't say that truth is also sane. It says no, truth is insane. It has to say that. It has to believe it. What it can say is that, truth and lies are equally sane. It'll say that. But it'll never say that just truth is true and nothing else is true. He'll say, no, truth and lies are both true. And the goal is to integrate them, or to be happy with the conflict. We can learn to be happy with that's diversity. You know, that's actually what diversity means, is you can learn to be happy with both truth and lies. That's the buzzword of the day, diversity, isn't it? Inclusiveness, diversity. It means both truth and lies. You can learn to be happy with both. To simultaneously together, both are true, and you can learn to be happy with that. In fact, you have to learn to be happy with it, because that's the new reality. That's artificial intelligence. That's the new reality. That's what you were created for, to learn to be happy and satisfied with insanity, actually. Hey, we're about ready to run out of space on this video. I get about 2.5 hours out of this, which is really a nice time, right? It's really a very good time. I think people can handle this. Our spirits, your spirit, mine, great minds that are watching this. Are you waking up to how great your mind really is? We're just waking up to realizing how completely awesome our mind is, how immaculate, perfect it is. Totally sovereign, invulnerable. We're just waking up to that. removing the adventitious obscurations, as they say in Dzogchen. You know, adventitious means foreign, not intrinsic, you know. But even that's a conflicted statement. There's nothing foreign to reality, you know. But where did it come from? You know, there's no defilements at all, actually. Defilement is impossible. It's our belief in defilement which is the problem. So we're removing our whimsical beliefs, is I would say a better way to put it, our whimsical belief system that anything could be wrong with reality. Everything is intrinsically pure. There's no way it cannot be completely pure. Pure abidance is the nature of reality. Pure abidance. Everything is pure abidance, all the same. Pure abidance. This has pure abidance. You know that? The quality, the identity of this is pure abidance. The quality, the essence of it is pure abidance. That is the spiritual essence of everything. Everything has the same spiritual essence, which is pure abidance in pure spaciousness. Absolutely. That's the heart of it. That's the heart of teachings right there. Well, I feel like I could go on and on and on and on and on, but I don't want to get burned out. I mean, I do get burned out sometimes if I tape too much. It's a strain because the backlash comes, because I say, oh my gosh, what did I say? You know, people can get very angry with me. The artificial intelligence people, you know, fourth dimensionals are going to get very upset with me, but they really don't. They don't want to pick a fight with me. Because they're going to lose, at least in a certain way. Yeah, they, you know, they'll instantly.